We have all heard it before. If you want to lose weight, you should do cardio, specifically while fasted. But what does the research say, and how does it compare to traditional cardio? Are there even better alternatives out there? Today we're going to look at 28 studies, so let's dive into it. First, let's look at a meta-analysis which identified over 10,000 articles through keyword search, and then was reduced to just 27 after being evaluated by their rigorous criteria. Now, in this context, when we're mentioning fasting, we're referring to a period of time of multiple hours in which an individual does not eat. A common method for this is an overnight fast, where one doesn't eat for several hours because they're asleep, and upon waking up, they would do cardio before eating anything. Now, in theory, low glycogen and insulin levels cause the body to shift energy utilization away from carbohydrates, thereby allowing greater mobilization of stored fat for fuel. And in fact, it was found that aerobic exercise performed in the fasted state was associated with a significant increase in fat oxidation during exercise. However, as noted in the other study that we will mention, this information will lead a lot of people into thinking fasted cardio is superior to all other forms. But before we get into that, it is worth mentioning that the statisticians of the meta-analysis stratified the data and found between fasted and fed groups, there was a statistical significance in fat oxidation for low to moderate intensity with a VO2 max under 70%. However, there was no significant difference between the groups in fat oxidation and moderate to high intensity aerobic activity, where the VO2 max exceeded 70%. And this aligns perfectly with previous literature, as fat usage has been found in many other articles to be higher at lower intensities, with the body to have an incremental preference towards carbohydrates with an increase in exercise intensity. Moreover, the study stratified the data by exercise time, sex, BMI, training level, time between consumption and the beginning of exercise, and quantity of carbohydrates consumed pre-exercise, but found no clear trends. Now let's get into that study that I was talking about earlier. A study in 2014 took young active women and provided a customized hypocaloric diet of a 500 calorie deficit with continual nutritional guidance and performed 4 weeks of volume equated exercise, which consisted of 1 hour of steady state aerobic exercise performed 3 days per week. Something interesting about this study, unlike most literature published to date, was that they controlled, or at least attempted to control, dietary confounding variables to explore the effects of solely fasted versus unfasted cardio. Unfortunately, after the study, the mean weight loss of both groups was less than expected, and therefore indicative of the subjects underreporting intake intentionally and/or poor measurement of food proportions. Nevertheless, they used the BOD pod for measuring body composition of the subjects before and after, and found no statistical significance between the mean weight loss between the two groups, suggesting that perhaps the modality of diet for fat loss in combination with exercise does not matter as much as we initially thought. Now, this may be mainly attributed to that after 2 hours of exercising, the substrate utilization patterns became similar between fasted and fed states, raising questions as to how someone adapted on a ketogenic diet for over a month would compare to the other two groups in the study, but that's a topic for another day. Maybe what matters most for fat loss is consistency to a hypocaloric diet in combination with exercise, as meta-analytic data has shown that a combined diet plus exercise program is more effective in promoting long-term weight loss than a diet-only program. Nevertheless, at the end of the study, the scientists had this to say. It has been hypothesized that exercising when fasted forces the body to rely on using fat as a substrate rather than carbohydrate, thereby reducing body fat to a greater extent than performance of post-exercise. Our results refute the veracity of this hypothesis. Although both groups lost a significant amount of weight and fat mass, no differences were seen between conditions in any outcome measure regardless. Now, sure, there are limitations to both studies, but the most notable one is the duration of the studies and the extrapolation of fat oxidation in some studies used in the meta-analysis by VO2 and CO2 production values. Therefore, these findings should not be extrapolated as long-term effects, especially with the aim of reducing body fat, as there's insufficient evidence of effectiveness and safety. Lastly, some of the data in the meta-analysis was extracted from the graphs directly using an algorithm, introducing the possibility of random error. Nevertheless, this research is a good indication of what to expect from both modalities. Okay, so that was a lot of information. Let me summarize. There's convincing evidence that fasted cardio does lead to higher fat oxidation rates. However, using fat as a substrate over carbohydrates does not seem to be correlated with more fat loss than traditional non-fasted cardio. In conclusion, when considering weight loss, it is best to combine exercise and diet, with a commitment to a hypocaloric diet being much more important than the modality of the exercise.